I'm coming all dressed up for you in blue jeans because my luggage didn't make it. And I was very glad it didn't make it because I didn't have time to change anyway. I will need your help tonight when you go home to pray that I make it back to the boonies tomorrow night because they have already 15 inches of snow. When I left, they had 25 below zero. And the airport's closed as I moved up here, so everything closed behind me. And I need to get back home because the next morning at 7 I have to catch a plane for Switzerland. And I can't go from here to Switzerland because my luggage and my passport is still in the boonies. So I depend entirely on your prayer and your power that I'll make it. My work with death and dying, which is not really about death and dying, it's about life and living. But I think a book would not sell if you would call it on life and living. Started about 20 years ago. And at that time, all I cared for is to take care of dying adults who were left in hospitals. Nobody told them the truth. Nobody leveled with them. If they wanted to ask a question, they got very funny answers. They didn't even use the word cancer in those days. And I knew that they were very, very full of questions and ready to just pop and to have somebody to listen to them. And all I did is listen to them, and I put together in this book, and then suddenly it becomes famous overnight, and you wonder, why do they make such a big deal? Because any nurse, any human being who can sit and listen would have written that first book, and that really bothered me, that you suddenly become famous because all you do is put together in words what people share with you. And what you need to learn in this life, no matter who you are, is to listen to your fellow man. And it starts with your children. Not just your clients who pay you to listen, but your next fellow man, your husband, your wife, your children. And if you hear and listen and really hear what people say, you see that there is nothing new on planet Earth. Oh, the same people need the same basic things. And once you learn that and hear and practice what people really teach you, and in the more worse shape they are, the more they are your teachers, naturally. And the more you disguise them, and the more you detest them, and the more allergic you are to them, you should bless them. Because they are here to be your teachers. They push your buttons. They tell you where you have weak spots, where you're oversensitive to somebody. And once you learn that and you become really, really open to when it's somebody else's problem and when it is your problem, or when it is sometimes both persons' problem, if you get in touch with what we call nowadays unfinished business, and you get really in touch with your Hitler, and all of you in this room have a Hitler, including me, if you become honest again like a child and acknowledge your own internal Hitler and do something about it, don't just sit on it and meditate it away because it's going to explode sooner or later, you know where, when you sit on it. And if you really acknowledge that Hitler and get rid of it, then you can all become Mother Teresa's. And that's, symbolically speaking, you understand. And it's very simple. It's not pain-free. It's very painful, and if you want to get really, really honest, then you again start with your children. How many of you have children? How many of you are phony balonies with your children? Be honest, start tonight. Sometimes Aunt Rosalie calls up and says, I'm in town, I'm so happy to be able to see you again. And you are at the telephone and you put on that sweet smile and says, oh, I'm glad to have you over for dinner. And your three-year-old stands next to you. He not only sees your face, but he also hears your words. And then when she hangs up, she says, oh, that whatchamacallit has to come again tonight. She's going to ruin our whole evening. Why can't she stay where she comes from? And hangs up mad. And then at 7 o'clock, the doorbell rings. Aunt Rosalie is at the door. Mother is old, sweetie pie. And the three-year-old says, how come you're coming again and spoil your evening? And the mother smashes him one and sends him to the bedroom. I'm only using a very practical example. I'm sure all of you have done things like this. What children learn is not what you say, but what they observe. And you have to really watch yourself and see how very, very young in life we teach them how to be phony balonies, not to get bashed, not to get punished. How many of you, when you were young children, were allowed to really get really sad and cry and let it out? What were you told when you were very young and you cried your heart out? How many of you are told don't cry? Oh, you're a sissy, here she goes again. Oh, you're a crybaby, big boys don't cry. The thing I got is, if you don't stop crying, you give you something to cry about. And that would stop you immediately. Anybody who is not allowed to develop naturally, and grief is a God-given gift. With tears and time, you can heal anything in the world. If you don't learn that between age 1 and 6, that crying is healthy and relieves you of a lot of pain, if you learn that early, you can cry and you can get it over with and you can heal yourself. If you're told, if you don't stop crying, I give you something to cry about, it will shut you up immediately. And you will sit on buckets and buckets of tears inside. You will all end up getting sick. You'll be marvelous food for psychiatrists. You will be marvelous food for a psychosomatic specialist. You will all end up with pulmonary problems or GI problems. And the worst that will happen to you is that you will turn into a grown-up who is very proud, being stoical all the time and never crying. But when you finally get in touch with your bottled up tears and anguish and pain, you will be the most unpleasant person to live with. And those are the grown-ups who marinate in self-pity. And you know what it's like to live with people who marinate in self-pity? It's, ugh. It makes you almost sick. And what I'm trying to do tonight, and I do that very briefly, this is a psychiatric clinic, so I feel very entitled to talk like a psychiatrist for a few minutes. I will show you how we are geniuses in making out of our children very unnatural people. And you are one of these unnatural people. And I would like you to get in touch with your unnatural part and to become natural again. It's very simple. Human beings, in my opinion, and that's just one model, consist of 4 quadrants. You can hear it if you don't see it. The physical, the emotional, the intellectual, and the spiritual. All human beings consist of the same. Some of them like to deny it, but that's their problem. When you work with dying patients, and I started originally only with grown-ups, only later when I had children of my own, when I had a boy and a girl, I realized that I'm shying away from dying children because every dying child, every dying boy reminded me of my boy, every dying girl reminded me of my girl, and I knew that I had to do something about it. And then I moved to Larrabee Children's Hospital, where there were mainly dying children, and I saw the children are much easier, much less phony balonies, much more honest. And they're wonderful to talk to, and they're terrific teachers. And I often say there are only 3 kinds of honest people left in the world. One of them are psychotics. The others are dying patients who have very little time left, so they throw overboard all the baloney. And the other one are young children before we contaminate them. So if you really want good teachers for your own life, work with psychotics or children or dying patients. And they are wonderful and they give you more than you give them. And I mean that literally. So very briefly, if you work with dying patients, and this is a general rule of thumb, you always start with the physical quadrant. When you start growing up a family and you have a newborn baby, you only take care of the physical needs the first year of life. That is priority 1 at the beginning of life and again at the end of life. You take care of the physical quadrant, babies who are lots of loved, hugged, touched, smooched, held, rocked, You give them the foundation of life. They should have physical contact in the whole first year of life as much as humanly possible. Some of you know René Spitz's book on the first year of life, and you know what happens when babies are never touched and loved. They may have nurses around the clock, and they may have all the right formulas, and they die like flies because they don't have that physical, loving, hugging touch. Same thing with terminally ill people. They need to be hugged and touched. If a woman has a breast removed from breast cancer or has a hysterectomy with cancer, many, many, many husbands don't want to touch them anymore. They move out of the bedroom, they sleep in a den, and the patients at the time with a heightened need for physical warmth and security and touch are the least touched. You understand my English? Yeah. So you need physical contact. With dying patients, you need to first take care of the physical needs, and that means to take every cancer patient and keep them pain-free, totally pain-free and conscious if humanly possible. We do not give injections to cancer patients, because with injections you can really dope them up and can keep them pain-free, but they will always be a little on the dopey side, and they will not be able to finish unfinished business and to communicate or to hold a grandchild or to do all the things they want to do because they're constantly dopey. Is there anybody here who works in a hospice or with terminally ill patients? What do you use in the Philadelphia area for pain relief? MST. Yeah. You all know about MST? You need to know that. It's an oral morphine preparation, and you give it by mouth. And you keep it on the same level. That means you have to keep it religiously around the clock. If you have false pity and say, Mom is finally asleep, she needs her rest, really a projection, you need your rest. And you don't want to wake them up to give them the next dosage. It will not work. It has to be a maintenance dosage. And the MST continuum is something that works every 12 hours. So you have no more excuses. So remember MST. And if you need any information, just write the postcard to the newsletter, which I think all of you got, and you can get the information. It is required to have a prescription, naturally. It is a blessing from heaven to have MST. With this, you can keep 99.9% of all cancer patients pain-free and conscious, and then you can give them the option at the end of life, whether they prefer to stay in a hospital for their own security, or if they are single people who are afraid they don't get enough care at home, or you can bring them in a palliative care unit if you have, or they have a hospice to choose from and they have alternatives. And I like to take almost everybody home so they can spend their last few days or weeks at home. And it's very different to look out through the window and see your own garden or your own farm. You have your dog at your feet, and I would like to have my cup of coffee and cigarette, naturally. And everybody gets what they're familiar with and what they're used to. It's a very different time from being hooked up on all sorts of tubes and in an intensive care unit with visitors only a few moments a day when you really need them, maybe at 2 or 3 in the morning. So you take care of the physical quadrant. And what I'm saying about the first year of life and the last year of life, I have to stress that this is also true for old people in nursing homes. Old people are not hugged and touched and smooched and kissed enough. And they become senile because the reality is so grim and they're so unloved and untouched and unwanted that they go off into a fantasy world where it's a little bit more caring. You have nursing homes where they tie them down in wheelchairs and they're incontinent. It's very pathetic, and none of you would like to live this way. You need to adopt a grandma or a grandpa. And if you only donate 1 hour a week to visit old people in nursing homes, take them out a bit. And if you're very smart, you will start ET centers. How many of you have not seen the movie ET? Not seen it. It's mandatory. Next time it comes to Philadelphia, go and see it. You could not pass my graduation test without having seen it. My ET center is my dream, but I have to live another 20 or 30 years. I want to replace the present-day nursing homes with ET centers, and that are centers for elderly and toddlers. See, the parents nowadays, mom and dad both have to work, and the children really don't get enough hugs and loves and touches and whatnot. And if we would bring our toddlers, and I'm referring to working parents, not parents who have the time to do that, but if working parents could bring this toddler to an ET center and the grandma or a grandpa would pick which child they like the most, and we all have very much prejudices. One likes redheads, the other one likes the black curly head, and they pick the child they like the most, and the only payment they would have to make for their living in that gorgeous ET center is they have to spoil one child rotten. And they really have to spoil that child. That's their payment for living in this place. And to spoil somebody rotten means not paying money to buy toys, but means when they come in, they hold and hug them and they take them on their lap. They tell them stories about good old Ireland or Switzerland or wherever they come from. And the children would grow up knowing very young age what unconditional love is all about. And the gift in return, it's kind of a bartering system, is that the old people would be touched again. Because toddlers crawl all over the old grandpa and grandma, and they hold them and they touch them, and the more wrinkles, the better, and the softer the skin is. And if they have a few pimples, they love to play piano on them. And pimples and wrinkles become very natural, beautiful parts of old age. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's a mutual gift. And then at the end of the day, when the children go back home, if mom is a sourpuss and father is cranky, they have already filled their tank with gas. You understand how I mean that? They're so full of love, if they're sourpusses, they have gotten their dosage for the day of love. And it works wonderful, and we have discovered that old people and lonely people especially, when they have a toddler who loves them and needs them and touches them, they do not become senile. And if they're incontinent, you know, they just put on diapers, and the toddler says, you know, I'm wearing diapers too. And they share everything together, and it's wonderful. So mutual taking care of the physical quadrant, lots of touching and hugging, and only when the physical quadrant is taken care of, you move then to the emotional quadrant. So if you are working with dying patients, you see first that they're pain-free, that they can communicate, that they don't have wrinkles, you know, on the back. What you do with people who cannot verbally communicate anymore, who are paralyzed up to here and aphasic, that means they can't speak, they have amyotrophic lateral sclerosis or a massive stroke, how do you find out what they need? What you do to find out? Any suggestion? I don't give grades if you don't know the answer. Just, it's very important that you find out what people need. Alphabet and blinking can take you forever. Yeah, I think very few professionals have the time. They have the patience, but they don't have the time. Eye language, how would you look at me, or I would look at you, if I ask you to scratch my back? That is ministry to a patient who climbs up the wall because he has an itch, and they can't make sign language, and they can't write, and they can't talk. Have you seen a speaking board? If you have not seen a speaking board, make it yourself. It costs 50 cents. You take a big cardboard. You take a big cardboard, and you can do it in any language you want in the whole world. And you have the numbers and the alphabet. And the 10-year-old child can go up and down, up and down, and the patient makes and wherever they combine is the word they want to say. It's wonderful with amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. It does not work well with stroke patients, because massive strokes, they have a damage of the brain where the computer doesn't work anymore to put the written word together to understand its meaning. It's the best way I can describe it. Then you turn it around. And the other side has the same thing in pictures. And anybody can show you which part of the body needs to be scratched, or they need a potty, or whatever they need. You can look at that. It's just important that you know that there isn't a human being that you cannot communicate with. And this is wonderful for any kind of language anywhere in the world. I had a man in Sweden. I went to Stockholm for a workshop. And a young woman called me up very desperate and asked me for a consultation. And to make a long story short, she had a 43-year-old attorney who had amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. For those of you who don't know what that is, it's a neurological disease where you get paralyzed up, and then it's up here. It reaches the speech center and the respiratory center. And this was a very bright man with two young children, and he has been lying flat in a lazy chair for 4 years, unable to express any needs. And his face was nothing but panic when I went to visit him. And I made the speaking board and I asked him what I can do for you. And he said, please beg my wife to hang in there. She wants to get rid of me. And I thought, well, I was getting paranoid, you know. This woman has taken care of this man for 4 years. But always believe your patients. Don't analyze them. I said to the wife, did you make arrangements to get him somewhere else? And she very meekly in front of the children said, yes, I've made arrangements to send him to the hospital on Monday because I can't take it anymore. 4 years is very much too long and I'm at the end of my energy and wits. And the husband, through the speaking board, said, I've been staying alive for 4 years to see my children grow up. And I promise to die very, very soon. He promised. It's very sad when a young father has to promise to die soon. He said, it will not last much longer, but allow me to spend the last couple of weeks at home. And I will try to be a good patient and not bother you. And she had tears in her eyes, and the children had tears in her eyes. And so I said to her, I'm going to this workshop on Monday. I have very little time before I leave. What can I do for you, for the wife, not for the patient, that you have the courage and the faith to hang in there and to believe your husband? Because if he says it's going to be a short time, he knows that inside. And maybe you would have lots of regrets if a few days before he dies you ship him out. And she said, she needs a man. And you have to be very honest. I said, what do you need a man for? And he said, she doesn't need a husband. She got used to having not a husband around. But she needs a strong man to help her to lift the husband around at night so that she can literally let go and sleep in one stretch a whole night without listening to the husband if he moves or falls out or whatnot. All of you can understand that. You cannot have one person take care of a patient. And I have absolute faith that I'm at the right time, at the right place. And I internally knew that I'm in Sweden, where I'd never given a workshop before, and that I have this consultation the night before the workshop starts, not by coincidence. I do not believe in coincidences. I call it divine manipulation. So I told her, I said, I'm here by divine manipulation. Tomorrow I start this workshop with 100 people. There are always a few men, women naturally much more. They always send their wives first. And if the wife survives the workshop, then they may come next year. So I said there will be a few men there, but the men who come to the workshop are special because they have guts to stick their neck out. And I said among those men will be one man who will perhaps come and become the nursemaid to your husband. So have trust and faith. I will come next Friday evening after lunch when the workshop ends with a man and he will take over. And she trusted. And I said, if that should not be right, because sometimes your intuitions are also not correct, I said, then I will come back and then we look for alternatives. You should have seen the first day of this workshop. I only looked at the man. I ignored all the women. One man didn't look right, the other one didn't feel right, the other one... And none of the men felt right, and at the very end, on Wednesday, which is the last time when people share their Hitler, one man got up And this is in Sweden, and he was from California. And I said, oh God, here we go, a Californian. And he talked like a Californian. And he was from, you understand, this was many years ago, but it wasn't popular to live on brown rice and tofu and wheat germs and all that stuff. He shared very proudly how he goes from workshop to workshop to workshop and how he eats all that health stuff and smoking and coffee and Swiss chocolates. That's a no-no. And the more he talked, the more I was turned off, and I said, my God, I'm not going to send people like this to my patients. And he sat in a, you know, twisted up position. And I thought, if any of my patients start screaming, he's going to go into a trance. And I was very, very, very judgmental, I must say so. This was many years ago. And by the time he was finished, I said, no, 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 God, send me anybody else, but not him. And at the end of his sharing, he said he's going to go into my work, into my footsteps, and he just waits for an assignment to be an apprentice. And I thought, I'm going to show you. You know, people who have workshopitis, you know, who go from Esalon to every Baba and every guru there is in the world, to mere parasites, because they only take and take and take and don't give. And so I said to him, are you willing to work 15, 17 hours a day? Yes. Are you willing to work night shift? Yes. Are you willing to work with people who can't speak? Yes. Are you willing to work with people who can't talk? Yeah. The worse I made it, the more excited he got. And I had absolutely no choice but to tell him you start your apprenticeship Friday afternoon. And he got very excited and said yes. And I must say, I was so prejudiced. I thought Friday at noon he'll sneak out and he goes to another Baba or Guru or Himalaya or whatnot. He started to work Friday afternoon. And I have never in my 25 years of working with dying patients had a better assistant. Never in my life. He even cooked meat for him. He did everything. He would have been willing to hold a cigarette in his mouth. He did everything for this man and could read his every wish. And my wonderful lesson I learned about my own negativity, my own judgmental attitude about what I call Californians, was that you should never underestimate the Californian. do you understand a bit what I'm trying to say? If you react, and that's very general rule, if you react to anybody or anything negatively, it is your own stuff. And so you can very easily diagnose where you need to work on. 2 weeks later, after I left Sweden, I went to England. I had a postcard in England. I'm ready for my next assignment. I hope you hear what I'm saying. There may be people that would turn you off, but in the right place, with the right kind of people, they are a gift from heaven. So you cannot judge people the way they look or appear or whatever they say or how they sit or how holy and holy they do or how health food fanatics they are. As long as they don't shove that in your mouth, it is not your problem. So if you try to get in touch with your own unnatural emotions, and that's your unfinished business, what you need to do, general rule, is anybody who turns you off or you get judgmental or nasty or angry, try to see what about the person does it to you. And then look in your own mirror and say, if there isn't a part of that in you. And that's how you find out. You have 5 natural emotions. Fear, grief, anger, jealousy, and love is the biggest issue. What kind of fears do you have if you give me 200 in 2 minutes? Just with one word. 9. Failure. Unknown. Loss. Come on, there are a lot more. Abandonment. Success. Criticism. You know that we have thousands. If we have plenty of time, we could spend the whole evening. They're all unnatural. Go home and get rid of them. There are only 2 natural fears, and I hope you keep them as long as you live. One of them is a sudden unexpected noise, and that is the instinctual God-given gift to preserve your life when you're very young, or if somebody shoots behind you that you duck. And the other one is falling from high places. You can put a small child on a cliff, they're not going to jump down unless they have a mother behind them. Honey, take care, you're going to fall. Then you're going to fall. So those two fears are natural. All the other fears, they drain your energy enormously. And since many of you are psychiatrists, you know how many people have phobias and how much fear they have. And they drain your energy enormously, and you can never be whole as long as you sit on those fears. And for every unfinished business is also a physical, what's that funny word, sequelae, consequence. If you sit on it for a long time, a certain system of your body gets sick. Grief, I told you, to cry. Time and tears are the biggest healers for losses. And little children who lose their security blanket, and if their mother is Swiss, neat and clean, and it gets gray and shabby, and they throw it out, you will never forgive that mother, because you're not even allowed to cry over your torn up security blanket. To be neat and clean and look proper, and what do the neighbors think if you run around with this dirty little piece of blanket? You know, that's a disgrace. Well, her need to be concerned what the neighbors think is not the child's concern. If they're not allowed to cry, they will spend the rest of their life having problems with losses. And the losses get bigger as you get older, and then your house burns down, and then your lover disappears from you, and then you lose a child, and the big tragedies, and you will never be able to deal with losses because you did not learn it young at age. So if you're not allowed to cry, and if you're told if you don't stop crying, I give you something to cry about, you will marinate in self-pity, you will have lots of depressions, you will also have lots of guilt and shame, and you're food for psychiatrists. And you're also lots of psychosomatic problems, and that mainly involves the GI system and the pulmonary system. Anger is even worse than tears when you're a child. What did you get when you got really humbled in your mad? I mean, really. What did they give you? Spanking? What kind of torture tools did they use? Belts? What else? Spoons? Brushes? What else? What message do you give a child when you use a belt and belt the child? The message is you're bad, anger is not okay. Anger is a God-given gift. Without anger, you would never learn self-love, self-respect, and assertiveness. And if it's maintained in its natural form, not piled up volcano that's ready to erupt, it lasts exactly 15 seconds. How many of you are mad longer than 15 seconds? At any time. If you have a real humdinger mad and you say, no, mom, and you're not punished, you will become the healthiest person in the world because you learn to say no early in life so people don't step all over you later on. If it is repressed, very young at age it's repressed in our society, you'll become very meek and nice. You all have read about newspaper articles where very nice guys are suddenly becoming mass murderers. Speck, for example, was a good example, if you remember him. There are lots of them. There are people who are never allowed, and they sit on a volcano year after year until they're... And all somebody needs to look at them funny and... So allow your children to be naturally angry, and then they don't have to become Hitler. And they don't have to be full of rage, and full of hate, and full of revenge. Jealousy is the same. It is helping children to emulate what they're jealous of in another child. They can dance, they can play the guitar, they can learn, they can read a book. And if we knock it into something very negative, then it turns into very ugly envy and competition. And love is the biggest problem. How many of you were raised, I love you if? That word if, what was the ifs that you were raised on? Give me a few hundred ifs. If you do your homework, if you're a good girl, if you would behave like your sister, if you bring good grades home, God, would I love you if I see that you make it through high school? And if once you make it through high school, I would really love you if I could say my son the doctor. Then you could become a doctor because you truly believe that they will then really love you. And you become a doctor just to become a prostitute. You're all prostitutes. How many of you, if you're honest and you don't have to raise your hand, do things just to be loved and appreciated and admired? And that is prostitution. I have many, many doctors who die. And on their deathbed, they're very sad. And they say, I made a good living, but I've never lived. And you ask them, why did you never live? What does that mean to you? Oh, I wanted to be a dancer, or I wanted to be a carpenter, but that was not acceptable in my family, so I studied medicine. And I did make a good living, but I've never lived. And they have regrets. And they're very, very sad and sorry. How many of you in this room, and now I want you to raise your hand, do exactly what you love to do? How many do not? Go home and change. I mean that. You will be poor, you will be broke, and you'll be happy. And if you're happy and do what you love to do, you'll be successful. It will take some time. This love is only love if it's unconditional and if it has the nerve to say no. You have to teach children no and mean it. A child who is raised with lots of love and no discipline is going to be a bitter failure. Children who are raised to become whole, the way we were created, have to have experiences of unconditional love combined with firm, consistent discipline, with consistent underline. If you teach them discipline early with love, and they have some experience of unconditional love, it doesn't have to be from mom and dad, by the way. It can be a kindergarten teacher, a minister, a neighbor, anybody, a grandma or a grandpa. Then their emotional quadrant will be very aware of their unfinished business, and they will have the courage and the faith in themselves to work something on that. And then, naturally, this develops all between age 1 and 6. All your basic attitudes will be done by age 6. So if a child loses a parent at age 6, they have already gotten what they needed. It may still be sad, but they got the basic groundwork for their life. Then the intellectual quadrant begins to open up. And in adolescence, which here in this country is such a turmoilly difficult time, should be the most blessed time of your life, because in the adolescent years is when your spiritual quadrant begins to open up. And that means that you suddenly begin to ask questions, what is life all about? What am I here for? Where am I going? With whom am I going out? And when this quadrant is open, then you suddenly begin to hear and understand every person in need. Not your projection, what you expect them to need, but you will hear. And the language of dying patients, and if you work with dying children, 99% of the language of dying children is a language of the spiritual quadrant, and you need to know that language. If a child would die at age 9 of leukemia, would be cheated out of the possibility of ever experiencing this marvelous evolution of the spiritual quadrant, that is not so. If a child deteriorates physically, that is, by the way, also true of grown-ups, naturally. Anybody who develops gradually, physically, in young age, long before the spiritual quadrant opens up naturally, the spiritual quadrant begins to emerge prematurely. And any of you who work with dying children or very young know that they're all wise souls, and you wonder where their wisdom comes from. That is what we call a compensatory gift of an evolution of a spiritual quadrant compensating the loss of the physical quadrant. Do you understand that language? If a child is born with very little functioning intellectual capacity, they are the wisest people in the world, like severe mongoloids. You think they're dumb. They're smarter and wiser than most of us. But we judge, we evaluate people by their brain, by how smart they sound. But those children don't sound smart. But if you would ever open an institution for retarded children, and you want to hire good staff that is born to work with these people, don't read their curriculum. They're all phony balonies anyway. You ask a friend to write a good letter and people believe that stuff. What you do is to invite all the potential candidates, invite a whole bunch of retarded children, and just watch them. From some people, they stay away. They don't go near them. You already dismiss them on your list. And there are children who just gravitate towards a person, get closer and closer until they begin to lean on them. And then you evaluate those people, and they will be the most perfect people in the world, because their intuitive knowledge of who that person is goes far beyond anything our brain can even understand. So severely damaged children or physically damaged children have an enormous, I want to say, hypertrophic spiritual quadrant. They're very, very intuitive, and they are your teachers. When you have children who are dying, you have 3, 4, 5-year-old children, and the mom says to you, Dr. Ross, don't tell my daughter or my son that he or she is dying. We don't talk about cancer in this house, and they don't know it. I just smile because I know that this child knows. And if they don't talk about it, they don't talk about it to protect mom or dad. But there is a time when the parents need to have the courage to know that there isn't one single human being who does not know that they're dying. Everybody knows it. They may not know it up here, but inside, there isn't a person who doesn't know they're dying. And the question is, do you want to cheat yourself from the marvelous experience of sharing this knowledge with a child, for example? And that's when you need to know the language of the spiritual quadrant. We use collages. We have lots and lots of suicidal children. We have also a lot of parents with murdered children. We work a lot with very high-risk suicide, what you call our people, candidates. I don't know if you are aware that we lost 96,000 young men in Vietnam, and 3 times as many of those who came back have since committed suicide. 3 times as many men as all the Americans who died in Vietnam. All because of you and me, you understand. Because we sent them out as teenagers, and we made killers out of them, and the better they were, the more proud of them we were, and the more, I don't know what you get, not the awards, what do you call that? Medals of honor, and when they got too bad, we shipped them back. And we did not give them any preparation how to live as a young man who has never learned anything else but to kill. We didn't give them jobs. They went into alcohol, drugs. Many of them went to Alaska to be left alone. And I go every year in January to Alaska to give workshops for people in Alaska, because there is one village after another. Former Vietnam gets flashback memory and kills every man in the village. Last year I was in Alaska in January, and we had to cope with 3 villages where all the men were shot to death by a Vietnam veteran, and then we put them in prison, and then we put them in an electric chair. Do you understand the paradox of this? Instead of healing them when they come back, since we ruined them in the first place. So if you know those things, and don't judge them, and don't put them in an electric chair, and don't put them in prison, but heal them. You made them sick in the first place, but I think our duty is to help our troubled and disturbed fellow men, especially if we have put them in this position. So if you need to know where somebody is really inside, not the way they talk, that is the front. If you want to know if somebody is suicidal, if somebody has been raised with incest, 25% of our grown-up population has been raised with incest. You're not going to tell your neighbor that you grew up with incest. But there are 25%, some workshops 70%, of grown-ups, men and women, have been sexually abused. You can never be whole if you carry this rage, this anger, this unfairness, and especially the tremendous grief over the loss of a childhood that you never had. Do you understand that this is a horrible? The grief over a loss of something that you never had is far worse than the grief over the loss, for example, of a child that you had a few years, then you have to deal with the loss of it. So anybody who has been traumatized like this, and there are thousands of them, understand them, listen to them, and the way to get to the bottom of the real, real pain and anguish and agony is to ask them to do a collage. If you are good at treating collages, if you don't project your own stuff and expectation into it, or to ask a child, a 4 or 5 year old child with a brain tumor, ask them to draw a picture. And all it takes is a sheet of white paper and a box of Crayola, and you can do it at any airport, anywhere. And you ask the child to draw a picture, and I can guarantee you that if you have had any Jungian training, and especially if you have taken a workshop from Greg Firth, who teaches this across the country, the names and the workshop things are all in our newsletter, then you look at the drawing, and this 5, 6 year old child, who knows intellectually nothing about the concept of cancer or brain tumor, will have that brain tumor in that picture. Do you understand that? If a brain tumor is left-sided, it will be on the left side of the picture. You can even find the localization of the malignancy, for example. And then your role is then to be a catalyst and to share with mom and dad, whoever is ready to hear, that your child indeed knows. They may not understand intellectually, but inside they know that something is bothering them. And if you begin to communicate with this child, and don't lie to them, don't say if you take your medicine or if you eat, you're going to get well. Because the child knows that you lie. And if you do that over a period of time, the children have nobody to talk to. Because they know, again, mainly on an intuitive level, that you cannot cope with it. So they need one human being who can do that. And very often that is an outsider who comes in. I was in Switzerland a few months ago, and in a big audience, much bigger than this, at the end of the lecture, usually there are some patients coming and ask for advice, and I looked into the audience and I saw a man who looked absolutely devastated, a total stranger I'd never seen before, and I had to go to him before I took care of all these people who wanted 5 minutes or 10 minutes, and I just left him and walked over to him and I said, "You need to talk." And he was on the verge of tears. He was ready to just fall apart. And he looked around the crowd and without words saying, "I can't talk in here." And I said, "Let's go in the bushes." And in Swiss, that sounds much worse than in English. But what I tried to tell him, it's 11 o'clock at night. The only place where you have some privacy is go out of the auditorium and disappear behind the bush and talk. And he had a little smirk on his face. What does that tell you? That tells you there is hope. If you make a blunder in language and somebody can still smile, there is hope, and it's a relatively good prognosis. So I took him behind the bushes, and to make a long story very short, he had one and only child, a 17-year-old boy, who the father was just told a few days ago that he had a sarcoma of the leg, that the leg had to be amputated, and that the prognosis was extremely poor. This was a soccer-playing kid, very athletic. And he said, "That is not the worst, to lose my one and only child. But the worst part is that I'm killing myself with guilt because I left my wife and have another wife that I'm not married, but live with 3 children, and because I'm Catholic, I can't divorce and marry her, but I'm really the father of these 3 children now, and a husband to this wife, and I'm absolutely convinced that God punishes me by killing my one and only son, whom I love more than anything in the world." And I told him that I only know a God of total, absolute, unconditional love, understanding and compassion, so I cannot help him with a God that is punitive and takes children away from parents and does all these horrible things. But I said, one thing I can help you with, I can help you to communicate with your son and help your son during this difficult period. And it was very late at night, so I told him I would stay in a motel in this little village, and the next morning, if he comes at 10 o'clock sharp with a box of Creole on a piece of paper, I would help him in 15 minutes before I have to hit the road again. Typical Swiss punctuality, was there at 10 o'clock sharp. His boy on crutches, very pale, looked absolutely horrible, came with a box of Creole and a sheet of paper, and I just show you two drawings and you can read it without ever having heard anything about Jung or interpretation of drawings. It is so evident most of the time, not all the time. All I say to my patients, whether they are children or grown-ups, draw me a picture. You do not tell them what to draw, just draw a picture. This boy was told by the doctor that he only had a virus. And he told the parents, both parents, never to mention cancer or that he has a very short time to live. So that's all he was told up here, right? I told him to draw me a picture, and he drew a tree that was literally dead. All the branches were dark brown, black, not a leaf on it. Must have been a very solid tree because the stem was real solid. That tells you that he must have been raised with a lot of healthy assets and love and growth. Very solid, grounded tree, but no life. There was one leaf, and the leaf was hanging here on the right outside branch, one leaf, and you had the feeling it would fall off. The interesting thing is that he had a tumor in the middle of his leg, symbolically speaking, but at the exact right place. And inside this big hole, which had almost eaten up the whole inside of this tree stem, was a big red, bright red bug. Red is the color of rage, anger, hate, pain, unfinished business, eating up the inside of this tree stem. We had the feeling in a few more bites, this tree stem will be broken in two and he has no chance to live, and then this last leaf would also drop off. That was the picture. Does he know he has a sarcoma of the leg? Does he believe in a virus? You can see that he knows. So while I talked and worked with the father who had much more problem than the son, I told the son, I'll be only 5 or 10 minutes. Do me a favor, do me another picture after the treatment. And you understand I couldn't say after the amputation or after the chemotherapy because I'm not supposed to interfere in a doctor's orders. So you always go by the rules. But you can naturally avoid the rules very easy. You just have to be very diplomatic, right? So I just said, make me a picture after the treatment. While the father sobbed his heart out and shared some of his skill, I don't have enough room, so I'm going to move the tree over here. This boy made another tree with the same kind of branches, but the beauty of the second tree was that every branch was covered with hundreds of baby green leaves. Like spring when after a rain, everything blossoms. The whole tree was full of green leaves, thousands of them. Here was the most fantastic thing, where this huge tumor was in the stem. For those of you who are Swiss or who have been seamstresses, knows what that means. What do you call the stuff when you fix pants? It was the neatest, most fantastic patch. I mean, gorgeous, I couldn't sew like that. It was at the exact spot where this was. Nothing in it, empty, clean, neat, wonderful. There was everything green. Here sat on the tree stem where that one leaf was hanging was a bird singing his lungs out, fat as can be. And all I said to the boy, what is this bird doing out here? And he said, like, are you dumb? He said he just ate this big bug. That was all, 10 minutes. I showed it to the father, who broke into crying, but crying of utter relief. And I said, now what are you going to do with that? And he said, I'm going back to my wife. I show her my son's drawings. And then together we go to the doctor, and he will know that an amputation is not necessary. I called him a very short time ago, and this boy is doing fantastic. Do you understand how much you know? All of you know all these things inside. And the art to get in touch with your real knowledge, not your head knowledge. Your head is wonderful, as long as it's only one quarter. If you don't neglect the spiritual and the emotional and the physical, if it's in nice harmony, all the quadrants, and if you get rid of your negative, unfinished business, which drains your energy enormously, then your spiritual quadrant gets open, and then you know all these things. And then you combine with what you know here, with what you know in here, and then you can hear your patients. Do you understand that well? It is so simple. We just have to become honest again with ourselves, and then get rid of whatever prevents us from being honest or from being able to hear what your fellow man share with you. Then we can all help each other, and in a way we will all be healers, not just for others but also for ourselves. But the other unfinished business, and that will only take 1 minute, is something I haven't mentioned, and that is not the negative stuff, the hate and the revenge and all that stuff. But that's very clear that this is negative. But all the good things that you never do. How many of you do not talk to your mother-in-law? Come on. Close your eyes and put your hand up. How many of you do not talk to your mother-in-law? There are very few honest people who admit that. If you don't talk to your mother-in-law for 10 years or more, that means you use revenge. You're going to punish her with silence, so she should suffer like you suffered, because you didn't fit into the image. That is negative, wasted energy, and what you sow, you reap. And that is a universal law that you can never escape. So if you use revenge and you become very negative, you will be, when you're dying, it will haunt you that this mother-in-law died alone, unloved, unvisited, because of your negativity, and you will be very sorry, and it will really bug you. So if you go tonight, I can't say go and steal some flowers in the garden, but if you can do that, bring it to her, and then you say, I want to make peace now. And if she throws it in your face, that is her problem, not yours. Because you have made what you call a peace offering, and what she does with your gift is her choice, and you're only responsible for your own choices. If you don't do that and she dies tomorrow, you spend a fortune for the florist to cover her casket. And it only helps the florist. Do you understand what I'm saying? So all of you have somebody like a mother-in-law, and if you can, how many of you have had a kindergarten teacher or a neighbor or somebody who was very special in your life, who really kept your sanity at a very difficult time, and then they die and you read it in your obituary and you said, I've never thanked them. Why did it never occur to me? Think about those special people and thank them, and you feel like $1 million. The timing is very important, so don't postpone it. And this is a gift from a student of Leo Buscaglia that says, remember the day I borrowed your brand new car and I dented it? I thought you'd kill me, but you didn't. And remember the time I dragged you to the beach and you said it would rain, and it did. I thought you'd say I told you so, but you didn't. And the time I flirted with all the guys to make you so jealous, and you were. I thought you'd leave me, but you didn't. And the time I spilled blueberry pie over your brand new car rug, I thought you'd drop me for sure, but you didn't. And the time I forgot to tell you the dance was formal and you showed up in blue jeans, I thought you smacked me, but you didn't. And it goes on like that. And there were so many things I wanted to make up to you when you returned from Vietnam, but you didn't. Don't you hear what I'm trying to say? This will become unfinished business if you don't do it now. So no matter how you hate them or how much you resent them or how much you love them and you never shared it with them, do it now. And then if somebody dies suddenly or by a coronary or does not have the blessing of dying of an illness or have time to still say things, a lot of people die suddenly. And then all you remember, my God, why didn't I say something nice? And the last thing you remember is that you were an egg. Do you hear what I'm saying? It's very important. We had a woman who was probably the biggest egg I've ever met in my entire life. I have other names for her, but that wouldn't sound nice in the studio tape. And she came a year and a half after her child was killed by a car. And she was pitch black from head to toe. She even wore, a veil. She looked like she just came yesterday from the funeral. And I looked at her and I said, you know, when did it happen? A year and a half ago. Then you already know they need to keep a distance from the to the world to show that I'm in mourning, don't get near me. So they have lots of unfinished business. She was a woman whose main concern was, what do the neighbors think of you? That was her main issue. She was absolutely obsessed with that. And her boy, the more she nagged that he didn't look proper and he didn't dress proper and he didn't talk proper, the worse he became. And at the end of his life, he walked around forever with his finger in his nose. And you know, for a proper lady, that's not very nice. And she would nag and she would give him a hard time. And on the last day of his life, he just couldn't cope with it anymore. He walked around with his finger in the nose and the thumb in his mouth. Simultaneously. Only children can do that. And she got into a total rage, screamed and yelled at him, and he ran out of the house and he was killed. Right outside the house. And this woman was so ill-treated for never giving him a nice word because it was more important that he looked proper. And she came to me after a lecture and I said, I cannot put the band-aids on you, I'm not the band-aid lady. Unless you have the courage and the honesty to say that you were a horrible, horrible nag and a dreadful mother, and you were more concerned about what neighbors think of you, and you can admit that and get through that pain and anguish and everything, then you can begin to heal. And I didn't think she could hear a word. And as a last resort, as she walked out, I said, if you would only know in what a wonderful place your boy is now. He's surrounded with total love and compassion and humor and laughter. If you could get a glimpse of that place, you would soon learn to dance again. And I know that, I don't just believe that. And I said, if you have the guts to acknowledge that you were really a horrible nag, and I used a few other words, ask your little boy one night when you go to sleep to visit you in your dreams. And maybe, just maybe, you will be able to see him and then he will know and I don't have to tell you anything anymore. I had no hope that she could hear. She looked very blocked in her black outfit. Next day she calls up at the unearthly time, screamed over the telephone, didn't introduce herself, no name, I wouldn't have known her name anyway. But she screamed over the phone and she said, not only did that stinker visit me, but you know what he did? He showed up with his finger in the nose and thumb in the mouth.
I work in a setting with handicapped children, some of whom the prognosis is not good, and we are with them as teachers and therapists as they are going through the process of dying and with their families. And I guess my question is, what would you offer to staff as suggestions to try to deal with their own letting go of the children and not feeling they have to sit with them one-on-one all day and watch every breath or feel that they are responsible if the child dies while they are in school.
You're talking about the parents or what?
No, I'm talking about the staff.
Well, if the staff has a hang-up, you work with the staff.
What would you suggest to the staff, though? I mean, how would you approach that with them?
There are terminally ill children in the stage of dying.
Some of the children, not all of them.
And the staff has a need to sit with them?
They are concerned that the child might die during the school day, so that rather than they're trying to take a staff and one-on-one as a child starts having episodes where their breathing is inconsistent, the staff is afraid to take lunch, be out of the room. There's just a feeling of responsibility every minute.
I don't know if that's responsibility or if that's inability to let go. There are a lot of people who love them who can be there and lend a hand, and if a child needs somebody with them, they will not die when that person is gone. You have much more power over when, and under what circumstances you drop your physical body. Many of my children wait and send the mommy home or have a coffee break or take a bath or take a nap. You look so tired. I'm really okay now. Of mothers or fathers who, you know, cannot let go, who always hover over the child. And then the child asks, you look very tired, why don't you take a break? And then mom goes home, takes a bath, takes a nap, and as soon as she wakes up from the nap, they get the phone call, Susie died. And those mothers can pull their hair out. Of all these months that I never even dared to go to the bathroom, why does she have to die now? It's very difficult to die for men when wives lean over the side rail of the bed and say, honey, don't die on me, I can't live without you. If you multiply that by 1,000, then you know how hard it is for a child to die. His mother and father and grandma and grandpa and everybody wanting them not to die. So they're very smart. They send them home or coffee broke or even bathroom. Then they take off quick like a bunny. Because they know when you're dead, when you leave your body, you can be with your mom even if she's 1,000 miles away. They know that nobody can die alone. That's the wisdom of little children. So, you know, convey to the staff that the child will not die if they need you there. They will wait until you're back from lunch break or whatever. That's the need, I think, the unfinished business of whoever does that. Work with them and teach them to let go. You're not God. Only God can be with everybody all the time. And if they can get through that idea, then they can relax a bit and have trust that there will be somebody with a child who needs to be there, not who wants to be there.
How do you handle the staff that says, not on my shift? Dear God, please, not on my shift.
You tell them to pray. If they believe in it and help, they will get what they need, not what they want.
Thank you. That's very helpful.
Hello, I am recruiting foster parents for children with medical problems, which include AIDS. And one of our concerns is the fact that when do we really get into the dying issue with the parents, the foster parents, as well as with the staff, because there is a lot of concern about the fact that death is definite in this situation.
I've spent since 1981 almost all my energy with dying AIDS babies. We have 3,000 right now, and we need a few thousand more foster families.
I'm
answering your question in a minute. I just want to do something. How many of you would be willing to adopt an AIDS baby tomorrow? Would you write down her address and him, his, and whoever?
I'll take your names.
I have 27 families, and I'm godmother to a lot of places who take care of foster babies. What we do when we, I'm like running an agency to find families who are willing to take on AIDS babies. Most of the parents of my AIDS babies have died or are in the process of dying. so they cannot take care of them anymore. Most of them have no husbands, so they have no help at all. And they're most of them in hospitals where they're kept, many of them hidden away, because it's a marvelous business right now. And that's another side of medicine, which is very pathological. And they grow up and they die in an institution with nurses around the clock, very few hugs. Many of my children have never seen a butterfly or a leaf or grass or anything. And all because of our pathological fears. They need a healthy, wonderful environment where they're loved and hugged and kissed and smooched and have fresh air in the garden and anything humanly possible to help them a quality of life while they're still alive. There are very few who do that. I tried to open up a hospice for AIDS babies on my farm, and I was almost lynched. They tried to burn my farm down, and they put glass pieces and nails in my driveway, and they threatened that I would have a hunting accident in November where they would shoot me by accident. And I don't believe in accidents and coincidences, so I wasn't afraid. But you need to do something for AIDS babies. The 27 families I have now who are willing to take 1, 3, 4, 5 AIDS babies, we tell them before they make a commitment to take these babies that for the time being you have to consider that they only die in a very short time. So they have a very limited lifespan, and you do that before they make the commitment. So they have no hang-ups about taking care of a child who can die from one day to the other. You also have to tell them that there is a chance that they get well. And once they make a commitment to a baby, it's a commitment for life. That means they may have to get them through school and college or whatever. So they have to make a commitment both ways. And then you always tell them that mother, father, grandma, grandpa, and all the other siblings have to sign that they're willing to be outcasts and to be treated like you know what, if they take on an AIDS baby. And the children will not be invited to birthday parties, and the friends who come over and play soccer or whatever will not come anymore, and the children in the family will have a horrible sacrifice to make, but they will be blessed 1,000 times. And if you only take families who are willing, everybody in the family, extended family, to make such a commitment, you get marvelous people, marvelous people.
Thank you.
What is your big question? You don't talk about dying, you talk about living. They may live 1 year or 2 years, but the blessings and the lessons and the gifts those family get, I can give you addresses of people, they feel blessed 1,000 times with every day they have an AIDS baby. And it's a gift from heaven. And this is now the time of the separation of the wheat from the chaff. And I mean that literally. And your choice at the end of your life is nothing else but to always try to take the highest choice. If you make your choices based on fear, you will not live and it will destroy you. And if you make your choices based on love, you will be blessed 1,000,000 times. And that is your simple choice that you have to make now. And time is running out. We have 3 million AIDS carriers and 3,000 AIDS babies. And every 10 months, we get another 10% more. So if you know very little math, you will know that in 10 months from now, we'll have 300,000 new AIDS patients. And in another 10 months, 600,000. And in another 10 months, 1,200,000. You can sit and wait until you're ready to help, or you can get off your tush and do something today. And the sooner you do that, the more blessed you will be. And the harder your choice is, the more help you will also get. I can guarantee you. I've spent my last 2 years with almost nothing but AIDS babies. I'm getting letters, dear Dr. Ross, and they don't even give the address. I have a 3-year-old child who is dying of AIDS. I don't have the strength anymore. He eats very little and he drinks very little. How much would you charge? And all I want is hop in the car and get this dying mother and this baby. And if I do that, they burn my farm down. And then I don't have a place for any of the children. And the big art of living nowadays is that you can accept that as a result of people's fear, and not hate them, and not judge them, and not criticize them, and not become negative, because if you become negative, you belong to the same group of people who are negative, and you will never have the energy to make it through the next few years. Do you understand what I'm saying? You have to keep loving them. And I think that's what it means, love thy enemy. So you're not supposed to call them your enemy, but sometimes you feel like they are. Give me your address. If you need help, I can give you some names.
Thank you. Yes, I do. And I think I've made a packet available to you.
Okay.
Hello. I am in a hospice program. And I've taken care of over 100 AIDS patients. And our big problem now is what I call second-generation AIDS patients, those who have seen somebody die already. And we're getting an awful lot of attempts at suicide and an awful lot of despair. And to be truthful, a lot of our doctors are kind of shrugging their shoulders too, and they don't know what to do either with it. And these are usually adult, intelligent men. We have mostly homosexuals. We don't have many drug abusers who are used to making decisions, and they're deciding they want to kill themselves.
My book is out, isn't it? It's available here.
Yes, we have it in there.
Read it and try to do what they started doing in San Francisco. It's an enormous support system with mobilizing an army of volunteers, because doctors and nurses will not be able to handle it in a few months. They can't handle it now. You need an army of volunteers, of non-judgmental people who practice unconditional love and got rid of most of their fears. And you get massage therapists, and you get the holistic health people, and you get nutrition specialists. Anything that people believe in will help them if it's done with love. And if you have an army of volunteers who do that, we can make it.
You think so?
I know so.
Okay.
I do nothing else, and I'm still alive and well. You need a support system for the health care givers also. You can't just take care of patients. You also need an enormous support system of the health care givers so they don't what you call burnout. See, the burnout syndrome doesn't exist. It's a nice label that professionals invented to have an excuse to call in sick when you're not sick. A burnout is nothing else but not being willing or able to acknowledge your own negativity. Because we always have to be nice and caring and loving and compassionate. You sit on a volcano and one day you just explode. Then you call in sick before you kill somebody. And so what you need, I'm not exaggerating, I've been in that place. So what you do is you start a screaming room in the hospital where the health caregiver can let out their and let it out on an inanimate object, and you'll have a much healthier healthcare group.
I work in a geriatric setting. We use MS cotton. Frequently, the patients reach the stage where they cannot take oral medication. At that point in time, usually sub-Q morphine is used. Is there an alternative drug? Because once the sub-Q morphine is being used, the patients are no longer with us. And many of them say, I'm not ready to die, and still would like to continue pain-free. What would be an alternative?
There are lots of modes that you can use the thing, even if they can't swallow anymore. You can give it rectally, you can give it subcutaneously, you can give it in drop infusion. They have these, what do you call these things? Yeah. The patches, there are a million ways to give it to them. We never had people where we couldn't administer it one way or another. Right for the MST sheet that my office sends out on request, and you'll have all the alternatives there.
Thank you.
I would like to know your thoughts, feelings, and beliefs about reincarnation.
I have my life after death last question here, so I'm getting into that as soon as we finish the earthly stuff. Okay? I'm very practical person. If you finish your earthly stuff, you have no worry afterwards, okay? But I'll get to it in a minute.
Your philosophy in terms of dealing with death seems to be that one needs to talk about it and resolve it, take care of unfinished business. What if your parents come from another generation where they don't want to get into all of these feelings? They just like everything. We're going to die. Nobody's going to talk about it. Kapoop. That's it.
All our parents came from another generation. All of them. I bless those who don't want to talk about it, because they're your teachers. If you have the illusion that patients have to go from denial to anger to bargaining, what comes next? Depression, acceptance, then you are all in your head and you shouldn't work with dying patients. The stages of dying have been so misused, it's sickening. If patient doesn't go from stage 1 to 2 to 3 to 4 to 5, there's something wrong with them. That's baloney. All I try to say, what you do with people who are angry as can be. But what happens now, nurse goes in, patient is angry, they don't even talk to the patient. They go to the nursing station and write, patient in a stage of anger. All it means is they read my book. It says nothing else. Maybe the patient is angry because the food is lousy and they have to talk to the dietitian. Do you understand that? You listen to your patients. If a patient implicitly or explicitly doesn't want to talk about it, what better teacher can you get than a teacher who teaches you what unconditional love is all about? Unconditional love means I accept you where you are at, not where I want you to be. And you keep
so it's quiet. It'll be fine for them, but not for me.
Yeah, it's your problem. Work on your stuff.
Okay, thank you.
The only thing you have to be sure is that you're not projecting your own unwillingness to talk about it. 9 out of 10 times, it is the person's unwillingness which they implicitly or explicitly express it. Let's not talk about it. Then it's not the patient's problem, then it's yours. But if you can eliminate that issue, then you say, what do you want to talk about? I want to talk about Niagara Falls. And they talk about the vacation at Niagara Falls 2 years down the line. Some may surprise you and have a vacation 2 years later at Niagara Falls. Do you hear what I'm saying? You talk what the patient needs to talk about, not what you want.
What can you tell me to help me deal with the sudden death of a child?
What does your heart need to do? You need to scream, you need to cry, you need somebody to talk to about your child day and night. Whatever your heart tells you to do, do that. And find the people who are willing to help you with that. And in time, you will heal. You know the group Compassionate Friends?
I belong to that.
Okay. It will take lots of time, and it depends a lot on the circumstances and how you were able to cope with losses earlier in life and all sorts of things. There are no cookbook recipes to eliminate the pain. But, you know, my favorite saying is, if you should shield the canyons from the windstorms, you would never see the beauty of their carvings. In 10 years, 20 years from now, you will know that this whole episode changed your life and will help you to grow enormously. That's not the consolation, that's just the fact. You have no idea how much inner strength people have. I had a mother who lost 3 children by murder. And she did not go insane. She started to join a group called Parents of Murdered Children. And she has helped more families than you can count. I had a mother in Indianapolis who lost 3 children by suicide. And instead of going insane and angry at God and lose all her faith, she's now working with parents of suicidal teenagers. What you get in life is not so important as how you use it, or what you make out of it. And your choice is when life puts you into a tumbler. It's exclusively your choice whether you come out crashed or polished. And when you come out polished, life will put you through another tumbler. And it will be worse. And you come out more polished until you're a diamond. And then you will see your child again. And then you dance together.
Thank you.
I work for a hospice, and we're getting down to more mundane matters here, but you mentioned about pain control, and one of the things I would like to share is we have used some specific drugs. One I'd like to mention is Roxanol, which is a concentrated liquid morphine, absorbs quite a bit sublingually, so a patient doesn't really need to swallow. It's in very small doses, it's easily titratable, and most of the time patients on that can achieve good pain control and remain alert. And if there's circumstances where that's not effective, we also use dilaudid suppositories. And both of those methods are things that you didn't mention, but readily available. Thank you.
Did the other person hear that who asked the question? Okay. Would you drop me a note and put it on the paper so it's on our form, too?
Yes, what would you say to a person who came to you as a therapist who was afraid of dying and who had some medical conditions that would warrant that fear, and who said to you, I don't believe in an afterlife, I don't believe in anything other than who I am or in my reason, and there's nothing you can say that would change my mind?
There's 100 reasons why they use the fear of death as their excuse to go to a therapist. It can be 1,000 things I can't tell you that in one answer you give, tell them this and then you get to it. It's such a nice, I can't say excuse, but there can be so much unfinished business behind the fear of death. If you have never lived, you will always be afraid of death. If you have been abused physically, emotionally, sexually, and you're full of rage and the unfairness of never having had a childhood, how can you be ready to die when you have never lived? So you help them to do whatever comes up. That's why we do workshops with 100 people. With 100 people, you have to be a rock of Gibraltar or a saint not to get in touch with your unfinished business. Because you hear such horror stories, and suddenly somebody comes up with an incest out of the blue sky, and 20 people start crying. And all I have to do is look who reacts to what, and I know what they need to work on. And they work on it, and boy, what a relief. And then they start living. When you just start living, you don't want to die either, because then you have just started to live. So you can't give a general answer that is a recipe for everybody. The unfinished business is something that you work 10 years on something in therapy. I've gone through medical school 7 years, 3 years psychiatry, 3 years child psychiatry, classical analysis. Nobody got to my Hitler. Nobody. And I thought I was okay. In fact, I thought I'm so perfect I don't have a Hitler anymore. Until somebody pushed the right button and I was ready to kill somebody. And I don't mean symbolically speaking, I mean literally speaking. For a dime, no less. The smaller the amount, the faster I would have killed him. And I got in touch where he came from, and once you get to the source of the anguish and the pain and the unfairness, then you can begin to heal. It's like a boil. You have to get the pus out before you can heal. And you can't meditate it away, and you can't talk it away, because it's all from up here. You have to get to the depths of despair and pain and anguish. And every unfinished business has its own physical means to externalizing and letting it out. Then you can heal.
I have a question.
Two more and then we have to go otherwise.
About how we can help children and adolescents deal with severe losses so that they can have productive, healthy adult lives and relationships.
I would do what we do with our teenage workshops and our children's workshop. We have one or two who are able to verbalize their loss and their anguish and their tears and have not been so conditioned that crying is not okay, or who cry silently, which is only a swallowing it down anymore. It is very contagious, and children are so much simpler. What takes grown-ups 5 days takes children 1 day. We achieve the same thing with children in 1 day, but takes grown-ups 5 days. And teenagers take 3 days. And you let it come out, and it's okay and acceptable by the group. Then it can help a lot more children in a short time. Again, on a one-to-one, it would take about 10 years to achieve what I can achieve in 5 days with one person. It would take 10 years with one person what I can achieve with 100 people in 5 days. I believe in practical approaches, you know, which are economical and people can afford it, not just money-wise, but also time-wise. And teenagers and children are so much simpler than grown-ups. So share the pain and the loss and what it means. Let them talk to the person who died or the person who walked away or whatever. They have to literally relive it. Then they can begin to heal. And all the should have done, could have done, and all the regrets and all the guilts have to come out. The only way you can get rid of guilt is to share it in public. And it has to be more than one person. Of non-judgmental, unconditionally loving people. And if it's genuine, not from here, but from here, it is followed by a flood of tears. And you let them cry with the noise, with the sound. When they stopped crying, then all they have to do is to forgive themselves. And the moment they forgive themselves, they're forgiven. That's simply, you know, concentrated, the tools we use.
I have a comment much more than a question, and it has to do with burnout because you mentioned it earlier. I have a friend that was a social worker and is currently not, not as a result of burnout, however, because her statement was that you never suffer burnout from patient one-on-one or families. In the work, it does not cause burnout. But the facilities or the lack of facilities meeting the needs, the emotional needs of those that are working for the particular facility were not met. And if they're not nurtured, it becomes very difficult to keep giving and keep nurturing those that we need to serve. So I guess I just wanted to bring that up because I don't believe in burnout either. I believe that needs were not being met. And then you have to
always be disappointed if you come into any life situation, whether it's marriage or a job or anything, with expectations. Last one.
I guess I can assume that you believe in prayer, and I was just wondering if you could speak to the therapist or the physician actually praying with the patient. Or client.
You should not do this if the patient does not believe in prayer because you impose your needs or your beliefs on your fellow man, and I do not believe in imposing your stuff on people. But the way you practice, the way you live, your patients will know very quickly that this works for you, and when you least expect it, they go home and try it out and it works for them. And then they come back and say, by golly, it works. I need to give you an example of why it works. I used to be a wishy-washy Protestant, married to a wishy-washy Jew, so I didn't come to this work as a very religious person who grew up on prayer. I thought this is all very nice, but not for me. If you work with dying patients, you will sooner or later, if you don't believe anything, if you don't believe in life after death, you will soon know that life after death exists. And I do this very quickly because I have to leave at 6 in the morning. So I'm going, if you all pray tonight, that the plane will not be canceled, right? When I work with children, when I work with people who want to know what it's like when I die, I tell them life is not really real, the way we imagine it to be. It's almost an illusion. We are here in school to learn lessons and to teach. When we have taught what we came to teach and when we have learned what we came to learn, then we are allowed to graduate. So death is a graduation. Some are smarter, so they graduate earlier, and some are procrastinators, so they die at very, very old age. And some never learn. But the way you look to you in the mirror is not you at all. That's just a winter coat that you will discard when you don't need it anymore. And I compare it for my children with a cocoon and a butterfly. And I said, when you die, what simply happens is it's time for the butterfly to be free, and then it simply takes off. Can you see that? And death is nothing else but the freeing of the butterfly from the cocoon. And since I work mainly with dying children, I have little ones too. And the little ones understand that much better than grown-ups. And they even say to me, I think it's time to become a butterfly. That's symbolic language, so don't worry every time you show your child a butterfly that they're afraid to die. Only grown-ups have such hang-ups. So I'm going to very briefly tell you what you experience at the moment of death. And for the skeptical scientists, I will tell you how you can verify that. You are now in a physical body. That is physical energy. You need a functioning brain to have consciousness. And consciousness should really only be used for a result of a functioning brain. When this cocoon is damaged, and it does not matter how it's damaged, whether it's a stroke or cancer or AIDS or a car accident or you're caught in an avalanche, what simply happens to anybody, irrelevant of how you have lived, for the time being. Don't worry, you know, what you sow, you reap is still true. But the moment the experience of death is the same as the experience of birth. You have to go through a black tunnel and you get out into the light. And if you're lucky, you have a loving hand catching you. So when the cocoon releases the butterfly, the first thing you will notice is that if you think of mom and dad here, or of your husband or anybody, you are, with the speed of your thought, you are in the place where you think of. So you begin to realize very quickly that time and place do not exist. They are limited to the physical world. And this is what children know before they die. Children know that when they leave their physical body before death in their sleep, they think of mommy and daddy, and they are with mommy and daddy, so they know that already. That's why they are with great peace, send them home to take a nap and take a shower, because they know if mom doesn't get to the hospital, I'll get to her. It's no problem. Here they will know that they're whole again. Children who lost their hair from chemotherapy, the first thing they say, I have my hair again. Amputees, my Vietnam veterans, the first thing they said, I could dance again, I had my arms and my legs again. So you will always be whole. You understand that this butterfly looks very different from the cocoon. The butterfly is always perfect and nothing can damage the butterfly. This is your immortal part that is, what's the English word, not damageable, that will always be whole. You can use psychic energy to heal, you can use the same energy to kill. And it depends on your choice, because man was given free choice. He's given positive and negative, Hitler and Mother Teresa. So if you use your energy as a gift to heal, you can heal a lot of people, but you can also use it like in voodoo, curse. You can kill people, you don't even have to be in the same room. So do not fool around with psychic energy, is what I'm telling you. Here, you will have all awareness. So if you have somebody who dies in a car accident, and their physical body is left trapped in the car wreck, and the butterfly is above the car, they will be totally aware of the car wreck, of the circumstances. They will be aware of everything, and awareness includes also to know what people think. So they will know how many cars pass by and have all sorts of excuses why they shouldn't stop. They also know what the rescue team thinks and how many blow torches they use. We even had a hit and run driver who was able to tell us the license number of the hit and run driver's car. I mean, you can verify all these things. So here you have all the awareness. So if you get to a hospital too late and your loved one had died already, Don't despair, because they know that you're there. They know more than they knew with a brain damaged injury, because they know every thought you have. And if you have never told them I love you, you can tell them I love you and they will know it. They can't answer, but they will be aware of it. How do we know that you're whole? We took blind people who never had light perception for 10 years or more, and we asked them what they saw, and they could tell you in details what kind of skirt, what kind of top, what kind of earrings you wear. Blind people, and that's not something you can fake. My skeptical scientists say that's oxygen deprivation. And you know what I tell them about that? I tell them I'm going to be here when you make your transition, and I tell you something about oxygen deprivation. The way you verify why you are aware of everything, by the way, including prayers. You had a marvelous example of a Swiss architect who about 3 years ago was in a horrible car accident on a mountain pass from the German part to the Italian part of Switzerland on a weekend of what is the equivalent of what you call the Rose Bowl game or something. It's a big sport event. In Switzerland, we have soccer games. And once a year, this big game happens in the Italian part of Switzerland, and half of the male population, mainly, crosses over the mountain to go to the Italian part of Switzerland. And this man was in a horrible car accident, and literally hundreds of thousands of cars were stocked up on this narrow mountain pass and couldn't make it to the ball game. And this man was declared dead by three motorist doctors who examined him at the scene of the accident. They covered him with a blanket, and he was totally aware that thousands of people is pitched a bad word. Well, you know what I mean. They really complained that they missed his football game. And he was very surprised that here he is in this horrible predicament and thousands of people, whatever you call it. And after hours of trying to clear that very narrow path, and nobody minded him anymore because he was declared dead by three physicians, he became aware that one woman's voice, way behind in this column of stranded cars, one woman's voice started to pray. And because this voice did not know whether he's a man or a woman or a child, she included every possibility and prayed more and more and more frantic that somebody up there, whoever, takes care of this person, helps him. And then it dawned on her, he may not even be a Christian. And she didn't know for sure to whom Jews pray to. And then she included everybody. And she became very frantic. I mean, almost like she had to do something for the soul of this person. And this man was so moved by this very genuine, not phony baloney, very genuine prayers for him, that he was determined that he's going to stay around and that he's going to stay aware as long as he had the chance to tell this woman that her prayers were heard. He was in the hospital 9 months, had innumerable surgery, and after 9 months he was able to learn to talk again. And he confided in his doctor and begged him to try to find the person, the woman in the car with this and that license number, to find that car, to find out who was the woman who prayed for him. And they found her. And they had a reunion. And you understand what this did for this woman? To know that this person actually was aware of her prayers. You can collect cases like this as many as you want. If you don't believe, you don't believe. That's your loss, nobody else's. But you can try if it works, and it works. So here you will be whole. Here you will be aware of every sort of people around you. Here you can travel anywhere to anybody you want to say goodbye. They may not be aware of it, but you can say goodbye. And here you will also know that no human being can die alone. You can be put in a rocket into the universe and miss the target. When you die, you think of home, you'll be home. When you think of a loved one, you'll be with a loved one. And then you will also know that those who preceded you in death, if they have loved you and you have loved them, they will be waiting here for you, and they will be recreated for you the way you have known them or loved them. Do you understand? This is real, but not reality. Do you understand the difference? It's like you dream and you see a grandfather, and you know it's grandpa, but you know the grandpa is not in your bedroom during the night. You understand? That is what real, not reality is. You can see them, you can touch them, you are with them. It's like dreams, you have your eyes closed and you dream, but it's more real than real. This is what you experience here. And they come here simply to share with you that death is only a temporary separation, that you can never be separated from anything you have loved, and that death is really simply a transition into another form of existence, if I can put it that way. Here, for those of you who are aware of what some people call guardian angels, Californians call them guides, my children call them playmates, I call them my spooks. It's all the same, you have different names for it. Everybody has a guardian angel. If you're in troubles constantly, you have a whole army around you. If you're clairvoyant, you see how much help I have. They're also here, so nobody dies alone. Nobody. And then when you have accepted and realized that your body is dead, but you are very alive, and without pain and without fear and anxiety naturally, then you will create, and that is very culturally determined, you will create something that for you means transition. It can be a mountain pass, it can be a bridge, it can be a gate, depending on your background. My experience was a Swiss mountain pass with wildflowers, because that's for me heaven. But over this, you will see in the distance a light that is lighter and lighter and brighter and brighter, and you will only see a glimpse of it. If you're lucky, if you have a near-death experience, only about 10% see a glimpse of it. If you have ever, ever, ever seen a glimpse of that, you can never again be afraid to die. Impossible. If you have a near-death experience, you have to come back. And you just got the little reminder that it is your choices that determine the end value of your life, any choices you make. Your goal should be to take the highest choices if possible. If you die, what happens is that the connection between the cocoon and the butterfly is severed, like an umbilical cord, and then this veil here closes, and then in this light you experience nothing but total, absolute, unconditional love, understanding, and compassion. And then for the first time in your life, you know how we were created, that we could have been this way. We're very rarely this way, but this is where we came from and how we were created. And then you review every deed, every thought, and every word of your entire life, and you're totally knowledgeable about how many lives you touch every day. You have no idea how many lives you touch. You can be a grouch and you make 100 people miserable that you have never even met just because you wake up as a grouch. Here you have all not consciousness, not awareness, but knowledge. And this is spiritual energy, and that comes from God. And you cannot manipulate that. You can only manipulate, man can only manipulate physical and psychic energy, but not spiritual energy, thank God. Otherwise, we would ruin that too. This is all love, real love, the way we are supposed to practice. And here, you will know how many times you took the lowest choice, how many times you made somebody's life miserable. You also know how many lives you have touched in a very positive way. And depending on how you have lived, or how many universal laws you have broken, you may choose to come back into physical life, like a Hitler could never return to God. I'm saying that in a symbolic language, you cannot return to God with dirty hands. You understand that language? If you break a universal law, if you take a life on purpose, pre-planned, you have to save another life. This is what you sow, you reap. And then you will have to make up for it. You choose how you're going to ultimately end up where we all come from. And there are many, many paths that lead to Rome, symbolically speaking. There are many ways you can make up for horrible deeds. I always said one day Hitler has to come back and find a cure for AIDS. And he will help millions of people and he may make up for some of the misdeeds. But that is my own fantasy. You understand, it has nothing to do with reality. And all I can say to you is that you should not be afraid of death, because death is not a nightmare unless you choose to make a nightmare out of it. It can be a wonderful, peaceful transition from one form of life to the other. If you have lost somebody, talk to them, pray to them, think of them, talk about them, and they will be aware of you and they will know. And in time, when you have completed your own mission in life, you will be reunited with them if there was love. Californians who have married 9 wives are petrified which one of the 9 is waiting here. And you don't have to be afraid about that. I have to go. Thank you.